الحمد لله رب العالمين، الرحمن الرحيم، مالك يوم الدين، إياك نعبد وإياك نستعين، اهدنا الصراط المستقيم، صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين.
نحمده ونستعينه ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. أما بعد، فنرحب بشيخنا الفاضل أبي عبد الرحمن عبد الله العرياني حفظه الله ورعاه، وأيضا نعتذر له ولإخواننا أخواتنا المسلمين للأسبوع الماضي، وإن شاء الله عز وجل نرجو من الإخوة ومن فضيلتكم أن يصبروا علينا وأن يحتسبوا الأجر عند الله سبحانه وتعالى. As we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and praise in Him, we ask Allah's prayers and blessings to be bestowed upon His beloved Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, His household and His companions. We bear witness that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah and that Muhammad ibn Abdullah is His servant and messenger. We'd like to welcome our beloved Shaykh Abi Abd al-Rahman Abdullah al-Iryani once again, and for allowing us and giving us this opportunity, this series of classes in the books of the Salaf, understanding the fiqh and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as it was performed by the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and understood. And we'd like to apologize for last week, and we seek that our brethren be patient with us should they seek the reward with Allah, the Exalted and High. وإلى فضيلة الشيخ فليتفضل مشكورا.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. ثم أما بعد، فلا زلنا مع دروسنا العلمية المتواضعة والمبدوءة بكتاب بلوغ المرام من أدلة الأحكام للحافظ ابن حجر رحمه الله تعالى، ولازلنا في كتاب الطهارة وفي الباب الأول منه، وهو باب المياه وما يتعلق بذلك. قال رحمه الله تعالى عن عبد الله بن عمر رضي الله تعالى عنهما قال: قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم: أحلت لنا ميتتان ودمان، فأما الميتتان فالجراد والحوت، وأما الدمان فالكبد والطحال. أخرجه الإمام أحمد بن ماجه، قال: وفيه ضعف. هل قرأنا الحديث الذي قبله؟
لا، لم نقرأه يا شيخ.
وقبله حديث أنس بن مالك رضي الله تعالى عنه قال: جاء أعرابي فبال في طائفة المسجد، فزجره الناس، فنهاهم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم، فلما قضى بوله أمر النبي الكريم عليه الصلاة والسلام بذنوب من ماء، أي بدلو مملوء ماء، فأهريق عليه، أي صب على ذلك المحل الذي بيل فيه. متفق عليه.
And so we begin with, and we are still in regards to and pertaining to our series of classes, our humble and our classes in which we are sharing with ourselves and you pertaining to the topics informed, starting off with the book of Bulugh al-Maram, or reaching the goal, by its author, Al-Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, may Allah have mercy upon him and forgive him. And we are still in the chapter of purification, still in the subcategory and subchapter of waters and purification. And we have reached the hadith, the 10th hadith, upon the authority of Anas ibn Malik. May Allah approve of him. He said that one of the Bedouins, one of the desert dwellers, came into the masjid and he urinated in a sector of the masjid. And so the people rebuked him and were harsh upon him. So the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam condemned him from doing so. And so when this man finished and concluded with his urine and urinating, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered them to take a jug of water, a container of water, and to pour it over and on that place where the urine was, as this hadith is agreed upon by Imam al-Bukhari and Muslim. May Allah have mercy upon them both.
هذا الحديث النبوي الكريم من حديث نبينا صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم فيه فوائد كثيرة. من فوائد هذا الحديث أن بول الآدمي نجس ويجب التطهر من هذا البول، ويجب أيضا تطهير المحل الذي أصابه هذا البول، سواء كان المحل بدنا أو ثوبا أو إناء أو أرضا أو غير ذلك. فالفائدة الأولى أن بول الآدمي نجس، والدليل على ذلك أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أمر كما في هذا الحديث، أمر بذنوب من ماء فأهريق على ذلك المحل الذي بال فيه الأعرابي. والأمر هاهنا يفيد الوجوب، يفيد الوجوب، فدل هذا أيضا على وجوب التطهر من البول النجس.
And this hadith, this noble prophetic hadith, has a great many benefits. From the benefits that I read from this hadith, the first of them is that urine, or the human urine, is considered to be najis and impure. And it is incumbent upon the individual who has this urine upon him to purify himself from it. Whether or not the urine affected, splattered on himself, on his body, on his clothing, or on a certain place, or a certain area, then this urine is impure, and deems those matters in which it falls on to be impure. And the evidence for this is then which we stated in the hadith of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in which he states, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered with a pot or a jug, a container of water to be poured upon that area where their urine affected or was on in the masjid. And so this is a clear proof. And this indicates to us that it is incumbent upon us to purify ourselves from this urine and that it is impure. And the order from the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam also entails that this makes it a matter which is wajib and an obligation. And so, an individual should understand this. And this is the first matter, and from the number of benefits that we understand and learn from this hadith.
الفائدة التي تليها وهي أن تطهير البول من الأرض لا يشترط فيه نقل هذا التراب من المكان الذي فيه البول، بمعنى أن تطهير البول إذا كان في الأرض المتربة أو الرملية يكون التطهير هذا المحل بصب الماء على هذا البول، بصب الماء على هذا المحل الذي فيه البول، وذلك يكفي في تطهير الأرض. وذلك أن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم أمر الصحابة الكرام أن يهريقوا، أن يصبوا ذنوبا من ماء على المحل الذي بال فيه ذلك الأعرابي، واكتفى الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم بذلك، ولم ينقل أنهم نقلوا ذلك التراب وأخرجوه من الأرض وأخرجوه من المسجد، هذا لم ينقل. فدلنا هذا الحديث على يسر الإسلام في تطهير الأرض التي كان بها بول بصب الماء على ذلك المحل، بصب ماء كاف على ذلك المحل، حتى نرى أن أثر البول قد ذهب وزال واختفى، فعندئذ تطهر ذلك المحل من الأرض.
And the second benefit, and the second point in which we wanted to mention, is that to purify the ground or the dirt or the affected area is not restricted or is not defined as we must remove that affected earth, that affected part of the dirt or that affected area, and remove it completely. That affected area in which the urine was upon. However, purification is established by simply pouring water on the affected area where the urine is. For the statement of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his order, ordering the Sahaba and the companions, pour over it with a pitcher of water, meaning over that area, that affected area of urine. And so the Sahaba and the companions, may Allah approve of them all, were sufficed with this action. And it was sufficient for them. And it was not reported to us that one of them or any of them was ordered or was told to remove that area of the masjid, that earth or that soil or that dirt in which was affected by the urine, and remove it completely. And this indicates the ease of Islam, the ease of this religion, the ease of the legislation. So, an individual would pour upon that affected area that dirt, that earth, until the effects of the urine are gone. And then there's no longer any trace of urine which is left.
لكنه قال قائل: لو أن البول على أرضية مبلطة، بمعنى هذا البول في البلاط أو في البلاط، فكيف يطهر؟ هل يطهر بالصب؟ الجواب: لا يطهر بالصب، وذلك أن الصب لا يجدي، فإن البلاط أرضيته لا تشرب ذلك الماء الذي يصب على البول فيذهب الأثر، وعندئذ يكون تطهير هذا المحل الذي هو البلاط والشيء الصلب بإزالة ذلك البول، تنشيفه ثم بغسل ذلك الأثر، فعندئذ ينشف البلاط من بول الصبي مثلا ثم يغسل أثر البول فيتطهر عندئذ هذا المحل.
An individual might say, if the affected area was, for example, some tile or for some ceramic or marble or something of this type of stone, in which it does not expunge, it does not take this urine, so would we purify and clean this place by simply pouring water over this urine and this affected area on that tile or on that ceramic and so forth? We would say no. In this case, the urine would not be cleaned and will not be removed and purified. However, in order to remove the impurification of this urine, whether it be a little child's urine or whoever, then the individual would dry that urine first and foremost from the tile. And then he would clean and wash over that area which was affected, and so then this area would become clean from the impurification of this urine.
ويستفاد أيضا من هذا الحديث النبوي الكريم احترام بيوت الله عز وجل وتطهيرها من القذارات ومن النجاسات، وأن الواجب على المسلمين أجمعين أن يهتموا بهذه البيوت العظيمة المباركة، فإن بيوت الله عز وجل عظيمة، وإن بيوت الله سبحانه وتعالى كما قال عليه الصلاة والسلام: لا تصلح لشيء من هذا البول أو القذر، وإنما هي لذكر الله عز وجل وقراءة القرآن وللصلاة. وقد أمر رب العالمين عز وجل بتطهير بيوتهم، فقال الله جل وعلا في حق إبراهيم وإسماعيل عليهما السلام: أن طهر بيتي للطائفين والعاكفين والركع السجود. وفي هذا الحديث يهتم نبينا عليه الصلاة والسلام بتطهير هذا المسجد النبوي مسجده، ويأمر بصب ماء على ذلك المحل الذي فيه البول ليتطهر المسجد من نجاسة بول العربي. هكذا ينبغي المسلمين أن يتأسوا بالأنبياء والرسل عليهم الصلاة والسلام بتعظيم بيوت الله عز وجل واحترامها والاهتمام بتنظيفها وتطهيرها.
Likewise, we understand and learn from this great hadith is the respect to revere the houses of Allah, where these houses of Allah should not be desecrated in any way, shape, or form, claiming them and removing from them any type of impurification, any type of dirt or filth, and taking heed of this and allowing this to be something of great importance to us. As the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told this man that these houses of Allah were not built for this, meaning we're not built to be urinated in. However, these masajids and these houses of Allah were built for the remembrance of Allah, the glorification of Allah, and for reciting, learning the Quran, and also prayer and supplication and invocation to Allah. As it was mentioned to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in regards to Ibrahim and Ismail, may Allah's peace and blessings be upon them both and upon all the messengers and the prophets of Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we're translating what it means, that you should purify my house for those who are circumambulating around it, and those who are bowing, and those who are prostrating. And so the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was very concerned, as we learn from this hadith, of purifying the house of Allah, purifying this masjid and his masjid, Masjid Nabawi, in Medina, in which an individual and a Muslim learn that it is incumbent upon him to respect these houses of Allah, to clean them, to purify them, and to not desecrate them in any way, shape, or form.
ومما يفيدنا هذا الحديث النبوي العظيم غيرة الصحابة رضوان الله تعالى عليهم على بيوت الله عز وجل وأيضا على حرمات الله سبحانه وتعالى. فإن الصحابة رضي الله تعالى عنهم لما رأوا هذا الأعرابي يبول في المسجد يعني في طائفة ناحية المسجد زجروه ونهوه وقاموا إليه، وما كان هذا إلا عن غيرة منهم على بيت الله عز وجل وعن تعظيم لبيت الله سبحانه وتعالى وعن إنكار لما رأوه من منكر، ففيه إنكار المنكر أيضا داخل المسجد، فما قاموا إلا من أجل هذا. فدل هذا على ماذا؟ على غيرتهم وعلى وجوب صون بيوت الله عز وجل من النجاسات ومن القذارات، فمن أجل ذلك هموا بمنع هذا الرجل العربي من البول وقاموا فزجروه. فجاء في الحديث فزجره الناس لما تقرر في نفوس الناس أن بيوت الله عظيمة وأن بيوت الله جل وعلا ليست محلا للبول والقذارات، وأنه يجب أن نصون هذه البيوت من هذه الأشياء.
Also, what we understand and learn and come to understand from this great hadith is the tenacity of the Sahaba, the importance in showing admiration and love and hating for anything to take place to these houses of Allah. They became upset and wanted to do something about it. They didn't want the sacred status of the masjid to be desecrated in any way, shape, or form. So when they seen this man, this Bedouin, this desert dweller come into the masjid and urinate in a sector of it, They got up, went to him, admonished him, were harsh upon him. This is because they seen that this matter was from the falsehood, and this matter was wrong. Out of love and admiration and glorification for these houses of Allah, for this masjid, and this indicates that they were from those who had this love and respect. They adored these masajid, these houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the rituals of Allah, and the laws and limitations of Allah, and the rules and regulations, and His houses as well. And it is because of this, they concerned themselves with stopping this man and prohibiting him from urinating in this sector of the masjid. And so, it is incumbent upon us as well to also have this ghira, have this concern in which an individual is to do what he can to stop the transgression of the limitations of Allah in the houses of Allah and remove any type of desecration to them, along with doing the best we can of cleaning them and purifying them.
وقد أقر النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام الصحابة الكرام على غيرتهم وعلى إنكارهم وعلى حرصهم على صون المسجد من بول الأعرابي، ولكن لما كانت المفسدة المترتبة من زجر الناس وقطع الرجل عن بوله كبيرة، لما كانت هذه المفسدة تتولد أمرا أكثر، وأن الصحابة إذا منعوا هذا الرجل من استمراره في البول ربما أدى إلى أضرار أكثر، فمن أجل ذلك نهاهم رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام إلى أن يقضي بوله، وذلك أنهم إن منعوه قبل أن يقضي بوله رد ذلك إلى مفاسد كثيرة وأدى إلى مفاسد عظيمة، ومنها أولا أن الرجل ربما لانقطاع بوله يدنس فخذيه وبدنه بسبب انقطاع البول في وقت كان الإنسان مهيئا لخروج بوله، فيؤدي إلى ضرر في المثانة أولا والبروستاتا كما هو معلوم، ثم يؤدي إلى أضرار أخرى في بدن هذا الإنسان، فيؤدي إلى انتشار البول في فخذيه ونحو ذلك، ويؤدي إلى ضرر ثالث وهو انتشار المحل الذي وقعت فيه النجاسة، وذلك أن الرجل إذا قطع بوله ربما أدى إلى انتشار النجاسة عن محل البول يمنة ويسرة، وربما قام فمشى واستمر خروج البول في هذا الحال وحصلت قطرات أيضا في المسجد فانتشر عندئذ محل البول. فمن أجل ذلك نهاهم النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام. لماذا نهاهم؟ إنما نهاهم خشية تولد مفاسد أخرى. هذه مفسدة، لكن هنالك مفاسد أخرى تترتب على زجرهم ومنعهم لهذا الرجل من استمرار بوله. فلذلك نهاهم رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام. فلما قضى هذا العربي بوله أمر النبي بتطهير ذلك المحل، فدل هذا على حكمة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم من جهة، وأيضا على شفقته من جهة أخرى، وأيضا على سماحة خلقه الكريم عليه الصلاة والسلام من جهة ثالثة.
Likewise, the Messenger of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Understood or told the Sahaba and agreed with their action and with their intentions and wanting to prevent this desert dweller from urinating the masjid and keeping it clean and pure and purified. However, when there was matters that will breed a bigger harm in regards to cutting him off from his urine and telling him to discontinue his urine, not allowing him to finish, then the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam chose for the lesser of the harms and the lesser of the evils and allowing him to continue and finish urinating. From the reasons why this was the case, and understanding that there was greater harms, and there was a greater harm that could have been done if they would have made him stop urinating before he finishes. And if this was the case, if they would have done so, they would have had a great many harms that would take place. And from them is that if he would cut off and not finish urinating and stop or try to stop himself, maybe the urine would have got on his clothing, would have gone on, got on his body. Also, it might affect his bladder, his prostate, as this might be known. Also, likewise, from the benefits or from the harms in which would take place, if they were to cut him off and not allow him to finish, that urine, if it wasn't, or if he wasn't able to finish, being allowed to finish, then he would have maybe dragged urine with him when he was, when he got cut off, dragging it or spreading it to the different spots of the masjid. And so, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam guided them to that in which the harms would be limited and the damages would be limited. In this case, allowing him to finish and then ordering them just to pour a pitcher of water over that affected area. This also indicates to us and proves the wisdom of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, his great character and high morale, etiquette and manners. Also, likewise, his concern with his people and his nation and his love for them, that anything should befall them.
ولذلك استفاد أهل العلم رحمة الله تعالى عليهم من هذا الموقف من موقف رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم من الصحابة الكرام في زجرهم لذلك الأعرابي ونهيهم عن زجره، أن تغيير المنكر ينبغي ألا يولد منكرا أكبر منه. فاستفاد أهل العلم قاعدة وهي أنه لا يجوز تغيير المنكر بمنكر أكبر من المنكر الأول، وهكذا لا يجوز تغيير المنكر فيولد ذلك التغيير منكرات كثيرة جدا. وهذا مثاله واضح فيما يحصل في البلدان الإسلامية والله المستعان من محاولة التغيير لبعض الظلم الموجود، فيدعون أنهم يسعون إلى تغيير المنكر فيؤدي ذلك إلى منكرات كثيرة جدا. يدعون أنهم يغيرون الظلم فيؤدي ذلك والله المستعان إلى حصول ظلم أعظم وإجرام وسفك للدماء وقطع للطريق وترويع للناس، وهلم جرى من هذه المفاسد الكثيرة. ولذلك يجب علينا عند تغيير المنكر أن ننظر هل سيولد ذلك التغيير مفسدة أكبر، فعندئذ لا يجوز، ومن ثم الصبر على ظلم الحاكم المسلم هذا أولى من الخروج عليه ومن الثورات والانقلابات لما يتولد من ورائها من مفاسد كثيرة. حتى قال شيخ الإسلام ابن تيمية رحمه الله تعالى: ولا تكاد تعرف طائفة خرجت على حاكم، أي من حكام المسلمين الذين يظلمون، إلا كانت المفاسد التي تولدت أكبر من المفاسد التي خرجوا من أجل تغييرها وإنكارها.
And this is why the scholars of Islam and the people of knowledge understood from this position of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his position of guiding them to that in which is lesser of the harms in which take place, in understanding, in weighing out the harms in which an individual should weigh out which would be more severe than the other. When the Sahaba and the companions of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to make this man stop urinating, and from this causing a greater harm to himself and to the masjid and its sanctity, the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam stopped them from doing so. And this brings us, the scholars of Islam understood from this great principle in our religion, in the religion of Allah, where an individual, it is not permissible for him to remove a harm or forbid an evil in which would breed a bigger and greater harm or evil. And from the lack of understanding this principle, we see this, unfortunately, in a lot of the Muslim world today. What we find in the different parts of the Muslim world, their efforts and them trying to remove these tyrants or the oppression that is upon them from their leaders or their heads of state. However, these efforts, and this is what they're doing, these actions, unfortunately, are causing a greater harm to befall them and a greater evil to be transgressed upon them and against them. And so we find that a high amount of killing takes place, cutting the roads off, search and seizure, deprivation or hunger in which might ensue those people and those places. And so People should be wise and understand, and have patience to understand these principles of Islam, where individuals should weigh out the greater harm and to see the bigger picture that might take place. Even in regards to the oppression which takes place from the rulers and the Islamic heads of state, you must understand by this principle, as it was mentioned by Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, that he said, and he quoted, "Likewise, we do not know of any group of people or a number of people in which they went against their ruler or their head of state," meaning from the Muslims, "except that their situation was worse than it was before, and except that the harm and the evil was greater than it once was." This is a clear indication of understanding of the Muslim and how he has to understand and go about dealing with the rulers and the heads of state and not revolting and rioting or doing any of the matters in which will cause a greater harm to ensue himself, his people, and his nation.
ومما يستفاد من هذا الحديث وهذه القصة الرفق بتعليم الجاهل وعدم التعنيف عليهم، فإن الجاهل ليس كالعالم، الجاهل لا ملامة عليه، معذور بجهلهم، فإذا جهل علم. فهذا الأعرابي الذي بال في طائفة المسجد لم يكن لديه علم أن هذا الفعل ممنوع وأن هذا الفعل لا يجوز، محرم، وذلك لجهله وعدم علمه. فبال في ناحية من المسجد، رأى الناس في ناحية فاتجه إلى الناحية الأخرى وبال، كما كان يفعل ذلك في بوله في الخلاء والفضاء في باديته، ولذلك لم يعاقب ولم يعنف ولم يعذر. لماذا؟ لكونه جاهلا. فمن كان جاهلا يعذر بجهله، ومن كان جاهلا يعلم. ربنا لا تؤاخذنا إن نسينا أو أخطأنا، فإذا أخطأ الإنسان بسبب جهل يدعو الله سبحانه وتعالى أن يعفو عنه ويعذر لجهله ويعلم إذا كان جاهلا.
Likewise, what this great hadith teaches us is to be easy and to be lenient with he who does not know, the unlearned, the one who has no knowledge. For this individual who is ignorant, he's not like the one who knows or has some wisdom or has some knowledge about certain matters. And so this Bedouin, or the desert dweller, he didn't know any better. And he was ignorant of this, that he is not supposed to urinate in these masajid, and that this is something that was not allowed. So he seen the people were in a different sector of the masjid, and so he went to the other side or the other sector of the masjid and relieved himself, as he maybe would have done in those open areas where he lives or in the desert and so forth. And that is why he was not punished. He was not held accountable by Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for his actions because he didn't know and he was ignorant. Likewise, this person who is unlearned, he is excused by his ignorance and he is not held accountable for it. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in what translates and what it means, when he say, "Oh our Lord, do not hold us accountable if we forget or if we make a mistake." And so this is the case. And this is what we learn. The individual should be lenient and have ease and have patience to teach the ignorant and to teach those ignoramuses or those who are unlearned, and be patient with them and to teach them, for they are excused and are not held accountable.
ومما يستفاد من الحديث أيضا خطورة الجهل ووجوب العلم، فإن هذا العربي لما جهل وقع في كبيرة من الكبائر بسبب جهله وعدم علمه، فبال في طائفة المسجد وبال في مسجد النبي صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وهذا لا شك ولا ريب أنه محرم وأنه من الكبائر. فهذا الرجل لما كان جاهلا أوقعه الجهل بهذا الأمر المحرم وبهذا المنكر الخطير الذي يعرفه الصحابة رضوان الله تعالى عليهم أجمعون. فدلنا هذا على خطورة الجهل، وأن الجهل قد يوقع صاحبه في المحرمات وفي الآثام والمنكرات وهو لا يدري ولا يشعر أنه يقع فيما يغضب الرب سبحانه وتعالى بسبب الجهل عياذا بالله. ولذلك قال بعض أهل العلم: ما عصي الله جل وعلا بمثل الجهل، بمعنى أن الجهل يقود صاحبه إلى المعاصي الكثيرة. فإذا كان الجهل بهذه الخطورة دلنا ذلك على وجوب العلم ووجوب التعلم، أن نتعلم دين الله وأن نتعلم شرع الله وأن نتعلم هدي رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، وأن نتعلم آداب الإسلام وأن نتعلم آداب المساجد أيضا. فبالعلم يتبدد الجهل، وبالعلم نعرف دين الله ونعرف سنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم، ونعرف الحق من الباطل فنتبع الحق ونجتنب الباطل، ونعرف السنة من البدعة فنتمسك بالسنة ونحذر ونحذر من البدعة، وهكذا. فيجب أن نحرص على العلم والتعلم بقدر الإمكان والاستطاعة.
Likewise, what we understand from this hadith is the danger of ignorance and the obligation of knowledge, the importance of it and its virtue. So when this happened, this took place by the desert dweller in this Bedouin, he unfortunately fell to a major sin, a high ranking sin, wal'iyadu billah. Urinated in the masjid, in the house of Allah. Urinated in the Prophet's masjid. Well, there's no doubt that this matter is forbidden. It's haram and it is from the major of sins. This indicates to us the danger of ignorance. And with ignorance, ignorance can lead an individual and place him in a matter in which angers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so he places him and puts himself in a situation where he might commit moral turpitude, matters in which are forbidden, or major sins. And as the scholars of Islam, some have said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not allow anything to be led like people are led by their ignorance. And this indicates that people, unfortunately, they follow in suit in regards to their ignorance and do because of their ignorance, their lack of knowledge of doing things. It also indicates how important seeking knowledge is and the obligation of seeking knowledge and learning the religion of Allah, the laws and regulations and rules and legislation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Exalted and High. Likewise, learning the Sunnah of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the understanding of the Salaf and the righteous predecessors. Because with this knowledge, it removes ignorance and does away with it. And that is how an individual receives this criterion, this distinction of knowing between truth and falsehood, follows the truth, stays away from the falsehood, likewise knows and understands sunnah from the bid'ah. So he follows the sunnah, stays away from the bid'ah and warns from it and its people, and so forth and so on.
ومما يستفاد أيضا من هذا الحديث المبارك سرعة استجابة الصحابة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. فلما نهاهم انتهوا، ولما أمرهم ائتمروا. نهاهم عن زجر الأعرابي فانزجروا، وأمرهم بعد أن قضى الأعرابي بوله أمرهم بذنوب من ماء ليصب على محل البول، فبادروا واستجابوا وصبوا ذنوبا من ماء وأهريق على ذلك المحل. فعلى ماذا يدل هذا؟ يدل على استجابة الصحابة الكاملة لرسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وسلم وانقيادهم لأمرهم. فإذا أمرهم بشيء ائتمروا، وإذا نهاهم عن شيء انتهوا، وإذا رأوه عليه الصلاة والسلام تأسوا به واقتدوا به صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم ورضي الله تعالى عنهم أجمعين.
Also likewise, what we understand from this hadith, we benefit from it, is how quick the companions, may Allah approve of them all, how quick they follow the orders of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and answer his call and obey, shows their agility in obeying the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam with no hesitation, no reservation. When the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ordered them not to go to the Bedouin and make him discontinue his urine, they stopped and they yielded from doing so. And then when he ordered them to go and only pour a pitcher of water on that affected area, they were quick and swift in answering this order in doing so. And this indicates to us that the Sahaba and the companions, may Allah approve all of them, were the greatest of those who followed the order of the Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And they were the ones who answered his call in obedience to him. Likewise, and staying away from anything they were told to stay away from. And so, if the Messenger Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ordered them to do something, they would do it completely, sincerely, for the sake of Allah, and following the order of the Messenger Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Likewise, if he ordered them to stay away from something, they would do so immediately, in its instant. Likewise, when they see the Messenger Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, they take him as the example, as their role model. And so they would follow him, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, to the T.